All right. Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity to be in your house once again, Lord, to dive into your word and to just enjoy your word and let it wash us, Father. Help us, Lord, to be sensitive to your spirit and everything that you would show us today. Lord, help us to yield to your word and not just let it poof up in the air and it was just another day. But Father, help it to just rest and take root in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Everybody doing good?
Fine.
Everybody awake?
I'm awake?
If you're not, you will be once I get started, I'm sure. All right, so this book Pastor Bob is talking about is a book that I found at the bookstore, Christian bookstore. It's called I Am a Church Member by Dr. Tom Rainer. They had these in cases at the bookstore, and they were encouraging the churches to get them and actually pass them out and everyone to read them and really get an understanding of what it means to be a church member. So I grabbed a hold of it, and I started reading it and went, whoa, this is awesome. Hey, Pastor Bob, can I give you a book to add to your 500 on your table to read when you get a chance? It's small. It's not, you know, too big. And he read it, and Miss Susan read it, and it really has ministered to us. So we wanted to bring you this word, but it is not going to be just me standing up here reading out of the book. But I do have some excerpts from it that I'll be very clear as to where it came from, because it is a copyrighted material, so I have to let you know that. But before we really get started into this, I did want to go over a couple things, just in general. One of the things was Floyd, whenever he was trying to find a church with like-minded people that he could fellowship with. He decided he was going to go to a church. He walked into the building. I happened to be helping lead worship that day. And when he walked in, I was like, this is the first time I've ever seen this man. I better get focusing on worship and stop looking at that man that just walked up in this church. Next thing I know, we get to talking, and he tells me his story. Why was he showing up in the middle of praise and worship to begin with? Why didn't he come earlier so everyone could meet him and, you know, interact with him? But he said one of the reasons he didn't show up in the beginning was because one thing that everyone wants to do when someone walks through the door is, hi, how you doing?
Fine.
So what do you do?
Nothing.
Where do you work? What's your profession? How much money you gonna bring in tithes and offerings? You follow? And he didn't want to go through that question-answer game with anyone, so he just came in the middle of praise and worship. But when someone asks you that question, who are you? Well, what do you think of? And just answer it within yourself. What do you think of? Who are you? Well, a lot of us would say, well, I'm a Christian. You know, it might be the first thing you think about. Or I'm a bookkeeper. I'm a teacher. I'm a this. I'm a that. But all those things that we think we are, what is our perception of those things? Willie, if you'll go to the next screen. This is I'll just show you the picture of the author who wrote this. I'll just read it off the screen. Dr. Tom Rainer, president and CEO of Lifeway Christian Resources since February of 2006. Before coming to Lifeway, Dr. Rainer served as the dean of the Billy Graham School of Missions, Evangelism, and Church Growth at the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky. He served as pastor of churches in Alabama, Florida, Kentucky, Indiana, prior to becoming founding dean of the Billy Graham School in 1994. He has served as a church consultant and church growth conference speaker for several years and is in frequent demand as a speaker today. Rainer is author of more than 23 books, including Simple Church, Transformational Church, and the Millennials. He and his wife, Nellie Jo, have three grown sons, Sam, Art, and Jess, who are married to Aaron, Sarah, and Rachel, respectively. If you go to the next screen, please. We all have preconceived ideas. A fireman, When you think of a fireman, what do you think of? I mean, we don't know this, but I mean, Willie may have been in a house fire and was saved by a fireman. So in his mind, a fireman is like the most greatest person on the planet. There may be another person whose father was a fireman, was never at home. So in their mind, firemen, they're nice and all, and they help save people, but my daddy was never home. So our perceptions of who these people are based on our experiences with these individuals, police officers, teachers, this lady doctor here. We all have our perceptions. What is your perception of your father? A father, a mother. How about our Heavenly Father? What is our perception of a church member? And see, our perceptions build our reactions. What we perceive as reality will end up influencing what truth is. And let me just explain that. If I'm reading scripture and I have had an experience with the Holy Spirit, and the scripture I'm reading is talking about the Holy Spirit, I can identify with that. And it gets in me, and I really understand it. But if I've never had an experience with the Holy Spirit, and I'm reading about the Holy Spirit, it's going to take God to breathe on that to make it real to me. Because it's not truth to me yet. It's not reality to me yet. I can tell you all day long what a fireman is, but until you understand what a fireman is, your perception of a fireman isn't full, isn't complete. So when you say, I am a church member, we can go to the next screen. What are you really saying? I don't know if you can see some of these folks that you probably know very well. Here's our church. Here's many of us. Some of you are on here, some of you are not. I just kind of randomly picked several pictures to embarrass whoever I could. This is our church. What does it mean to be a church member? We all have different perceptions. We all believe a certain thing, but what is truth? How can we all come together and have a balance in our understanding? What is truth? You see this right here? If we're all focused on what this says, we're going to have unity. If our perception of this is based on study, prayer, understanding, and love, if my understanding of something is a little different than Willie's or Pastor Bob's, but yet we can communicate with it on a loving way, in a loving way, we're going to keep unity. But the truth is still the truth, no matter what our perceptions are. Amen? God's word is always truth, no matter how you slice it. 1 Corinthians 1, 10 through 13 says this. And this is in the English Standard Version. I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree. Oh, wow. And that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind with the same judgment. We all agree. Well, I've heard that phrase, well, I agree to disagree. Well, okay, you're still agreeing. If you have to agree to disagree on a subject to keep harmony and peace and unity, then so be it. Right. But let's not let it affect the church, right? The next screen. We will live in the environment that we create. If we use our mouths to cause hostility, well, I think it should be done this way. Well, I think it should be done that way. It's going to cause a chaotic environment. I mean, look at in the natural, in our homes. We create our atmosphere. We create our environment. Is it organized? Is it clean? Or do you just not care and just throw things all over the place? Now, I'm not trying to bring condemnation on anyone who may live like this. But in the nutshell, you will live in the environment that you create. So we cannot complain about the environment we're in if we're a part of that environment's creation. If we create a church environment based on judgment, constantly judging, then that environment is what we'll live in. And y'all know, I mean, we're pretty open here. We got a lot of core people that have been here for a long time. We've got people that come and go. We have all learned each other's character and understand each other. And I have seen so much growth just in the past 5 years, I would even say, of how we interact with each other is just such a blessing. It's really encouraging. We cannot judge others' righteousness by their trials. Let me give you an example. Job. Righteous Job. What were his friends saying to him, those so-called friends? Dude, obviously there's sin in your life. They were looking at his trials. They were looking at his situation. Obviously, you need to seek the Lord. But you can't judge a person and their righteousness by the trials they're going through. Look at Paul. God said, I'm not going to take that thorn. Well, are we going to judge Paul and say, oh, you must not be righteous because you still have it. God must not have, or if we still are carrying around sickness in our body or something's wrong with us. Oh, we're going to judge that person. They must not be righteous because God's not healing them. As a body of believers, as members of the body, we are not to point and say, well, they must have sin in their life because this is happening to them. My hand, you know, we talk about the body. And we know in Scripture in Corinthians where it talks about how we are all members of one body. And Paul interacts with that and he talks about how the different parts of the body function. Now, if my hand isn't happy with something, like my face is itching, my hand's going to help my face, right? It's going to scratch my face. Is it going to smack my face? What's wrong with you? You're itching. No, we don't treat our body parts that way, so we shouldn't treat our other body parts that way in the spiritual. So you're a church member. But what does that mean? What does it really mean? And does the Bible even talk about church membership? Well, as I've said before in different teachings, first it's natural, then it's spiritual. We have got this thing going on now and has been going on for years where science and Christianity has been at war nonstop. Can I tell you something? The Bible and science go hand in hand. You cannot tear it apart. There is no way. And the more I study, the more I learn, I'm seeing like, whoa, it really complements each other. 1 Corinthians 15:46. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, then the spiritual. Give you an example. How long does it take for a baby to grow in its mother's womb? 40 weeks. 40 weeks from the time of conception. 40 weeks. How long did it take them to build the parts of the tabernacle in the wilderness from beginning to end? 40 weeks. Guess what? We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. See how that all ties in? The natural, the spiritual. If you want to understand spiritual truth, we have to understand it in the natural. So, let's look at a family in the natural. Just a family. Family. Now, we wanted to, you know, kind of understand family no matter how dysfunctional your family may be. Think of family as a unit. You know, you have a mother and a father and the children. Your family may not have had all those parts. You may have had a stepfather or a stepsister or stepbrother or anything else, but needless to say, you had a family. Now, God himself wanted a family. That's why he created Adam and Eve to begin with. He wanted to be able to fellowship, have communion with somebody, someone. So the animals weren't kicking it. He wasn't talking to the cow. So he created us in his image. Okay, but what does that even mean? He created us in his image. Let's look at the next frame. Most of us have seen this before. God is a triune being, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Guess what? You are created in his image, a three-part being. You have your spirit, you have your flesh, and you have your soul, your mind, will, and emotions. You are a triune being. The animals are not triune. You are. The Bible says you were created in his image. So with that in mind, he wanted to communicate with us how? I believe he wants to communicate with us in every single area of our being. Our spirit. I believe he wants to speak to our mind, our will, our emotions. I believe he wants to speak life into our bodies. I believe that he wants to interact with us on every single level. I really believe that. How many of you in here have heard the Lord speak to you so strongly it was like, whoa, you really thought it was audible, like it was that strong? And it was like, okay, do I really ever want to hear that again? It's that powerful. God speaks to his children. His children know his voice. That's not to bring condemnation to you if you're not familiar with hearing the Lord's voice, but ask him to speak to you and start listening, watching. You're going to hear him in your spirit. Most of the time, he speaks spirit to spirit. But he wanted a family. How do we act with our families, generally? Did you ever get in a fight with your brother or your sister? Did you ever smart off to your parents? And when you picked yourself off of the floor, did you? Yes. You have conflict, but what happens in a marriage when there's no communication? It falls apart. God wants families to be strong. They are to be in communion with one another. You know, Willie was sharing with us about the Great Revival at the time. It was like focusing on the family unit. And this teaching that we're bringing forth does the same thing. It focuses on the family. So understand your family, how it communicates, it talks, it loves. It doesn't say, oh, you stink today, you can't come in the house. It says, here, go take a shower. Here's the water. Here's the wash rag. Go wash yourself up. It says, here's your meal. Come eat. No matter what you did that day, no matter what you stunk, you know, none of that. None of that matters. None of that matters. You don't think about what they did 3, 4, 5 days ago and bring it back in their face. You just function. You just help each other. You just serve each other. You meet the needs of your family. Well, same thing in the body of Christ. I'd like to go ahead and read this section. This is in the book, and this is from page 2 to page 4, and it really sets the tone for why Dr. Rayner actually decided to write this book to begin with. And it has to do with, it's called A Tale of Two Church Members. And there's these two guys, Michael and Liam, and they met each other in church, and they spent a lot of quality time together, and they just really hit it off. And they decided, you know what, let's just start having breakfast on Monday morning, and let's just talk. They talked football, they talked all kinds of stuff. They enjoyed their time together. So early in their friendship, the conversation focused on sports, family, and politics. They had much in common. Michael was 41, and Liam was 39. They each had 3 kids, and they were both college football fanatics. Each of their team was in the same football conference, but they were pretty fierce rivals as well. The guys thoroughly enjoyed trash-talking the other's team in a friendly spirit. I mean, we ain't talking about no Clemson or, you know, any of that today. But on this particular Monday morning, the conversation turned serious. Michael and his wife had noticed some changes in the demeanor of Liam in their Bible study group. He no longer seemed as interested in studying and discussing the Bible as he did talking about their church. And his comments were often critical about the congregation and where the two families both had their memberships. Still, Michael was caught off guard on that particular Monday morning, and Liam loved the poached eggs in the little restaurant. It was his regular order. But this Monday morning, he had not even touched them. Barely even sipping his coffee. Liam didn't take long to get to the point. Michael, he began, Lana and I have decided to leave the church. The pause seemed to last minutes. Neither of the men seemed to know who should speak next. Michael took the initiative and spoke softly and deliberately. "Do you want to tell me about it?" Michael inquired. He honestly didn't know if Liam wanted to say anything more about it. His friends seemed a little resolute. Nevertheless, Liam began to explain his feelings and decision. "Lana and I went to the church to learn deep truths about the Bible," Liam offered. "But Pastor Robert is just not feeding us. We're not getting anything out of his messages. Sitting in the service on Sunday morning is just a waste of time." Michael didn't respond. "Good idea." He could tell Liam had more to say. "There are several great people in our church," Liam continued. "You and Karen are the best, and there are a few more like you." He paused, and his facial expression became even more serious. "But honestly, Michael, our church is full of hypocrites. Did you hear Jim at the kids' basketball game? He embarrassed me the way he was screaming at the refs. What kind of testimony is that for a Christian? And of course, everyone knows about Neil. He was supposedly this pillar of the church, and we found out he's been cheating on his wife for over a year. What kind of church is this with these kind of people?" Liam was angry, but controlled as he went and continued to vent. "Look, Pastor Robert acts like he cares for us, but I'm not so sure he does. I told him that Lana's dad was in the hospital for hernia surgery, and he never visited him." Michael knew that Lana's father was not a church member and that he lived 50 miles away. He also knew that Pastor Robert called him and had prayer with him. But he also knew that any rebuttal would not be appreciated at the moment. So Michael again held his tongue. Now it seemed that Liam's mild rant was winding down, and Liam seemed exhausted, ready to bring the conversation to a close. He did, however, offer a few pointed comments and two insightful questions. "Michael," Liam began softly, "I really like you and Karen and your kids. All of you are a class act." He paused briefly. "But you seem enthused about the church. You keep serving and contributing. Don't take me wrong, but I wonder at times if you're blind to all the problems in the church." Then Liam offered a closing that really spoke more than he realized. "We are really two different types of church members," he stated. "Why is that? Why do we have such different perspectives?" Now, I know a lot of us have interacted with people like Michael and people like Liam. Let's go ahead to our next frame there. I'm going to continue to read just a little bit about the foundation of this book and how it all was set out. Go ahead. You may not be able to read this. I thought my words were big enough for this, but that's okay. It was a big deal for this young boy living in the small southern town. This is a totally different story. I didn't know what a country club was, but I knew one was coming to town. And it included a swimming pool, a dining area, and meeting rooms. The owners also promised to build a small golf course, a promise that they would fulfill a couple of years later. Now, don't get the wrong impression. This country club was not the typical upscale clubs that we often envision. It was really a small private enterprise trying to make a few bucks in a small town by offering a few amenities. But I was overwhelmed. My parents were middle class in income, so they could afford the small monthly fee. From my perspective, though, I had it made. I could now go to a swimming pool. I didn't know of anyone who had their own pool in this town, so this amenity was exciting. I could order a burger from the dining area, and we could have birthday parties in the pool or in the meeting rooms. I began to learn a lesson. Membership means perks. Membership means privileges. Membership means others will serve me. Just pay the going rate and you can have others taking care of you while you enjoy a life of luxury and leisure. And tragically, this understanding of membership is what many church members hold. "This is my church, so you have to play the music that I want," Look, Pastor, you need to remember who pays your salary. If you don't do this program, I'm going to withhold my check from the church. I've been a member of this church for over 30 years, so I have a right to get what I want. I don't pay good money to this church to listen to sermons that long. All right, you get the picture. These unfortunately typical comments come from members of churches who have had an unbiblical view of membership. Their view of membership is more aligned with country club memberships. For them, membership is about receiving instead of giving, being served instead of serving, rights instead of responsibilities, and entitlements instead of sacrifices. This wrongful view of membership sees the tithes and offerings as membership dues that entitle members to a never-ending list of privileges and expectations instead of an unconditional, cheerful gift to God. Membership means we are all necessary parts of the whole. Let's say that again. Membership means we are all necessary parts of the whole. How many of you felt like, wow, where's Shirley today when she wasn't here? You feel like a part of you is missing, like, where is she? Any of you, when you're not here, I'm like, where are they? Where are they? Where are they? Because you feel their absence. You know they're gone. Next slide. With a country club membership, you pay others to do the work for you. With a church membership, everyone has a role or a function. This is why some are hands. Thank you, Siri. Some are feet, ears, or eyes. We are all different, but we are necessary parts of the whole. Each part, therefore, has to do its work, or the whole body suffers. What if my kidneys stop working right now? I'm going to get real sick. What if my lungs aren't working? What if my heart stops? Well, heaven ain't too bad, but what if my heart stops? What if I lose my big toe, which gives me my balance? How hard would it be to walk? This is a beautiful diversity in the midst of unity in church membership. The Bible makes it clear that if one part does not do its job, the whole body does not function well. But if one part does its job well, the whole body rejoices and is stronger. And in 1 Corinthians 12:26, this is what it says. So if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. If one member is honored, then all the members rejoice with it. And in the next slide, Romans 12, and this is verse 4 through 6. For just as we have many members in one body, and all the members do not have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Since we have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, each of us is to exercise them accordingly. We always want to fit in. We want to fit into something. There are certain things that we as humans in our own flesh, we like and don't like. We don't like change. We like routine. We get up a certain time. We have a certain thing for breakfast. We work until a certain hour. We come home, we eat our dinner. We watch our favorite show. We go to bed, sleep, and do it all over the next day. We have a certain routine, and once we get into that routine, we don't want our routine changing. Who's that knocking on my door? I don't want to let them up in my house. I'm in the middle of watching my show. Don't they know it's 8 o'clock? We get all antsy and everything, and we don't go with the flow of the Spirit. We need to let the Holy Spirit take control, and not us with our scheduling, and everything has to be a certain way. Talk to me about that, because I'm the scheduler. I mean, there's no way I could do half of what I do without a schedule, but I will tell you one thing. I have taken that schedule and set it right over there. And many of you know this already. And we'll take your phone call, we'll take your knock at the door in a skinny minute. We want to fit in. That's who we are. We want to communicate. We want to be able to look someone in the eyes and talk to them and have them understand the part of us that we don't share with everybody. It's a part of who we are. That's what we want. And God is standing there the whole time saying, I'm right here. I'm right here. Draw near to me. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be given to you. Don't worry about anything. And as we seek him as a body, and we're not the members that are waiting for the perks. Oh, we get to listen to some good music today. We get to go eat some grub. Man, someone's brought some coleslaw and some ham and turkey. And, you know, we're all excited about coming in and laughing with our friends. And that's great. But what if all the perks were gone? What if we had a Sunday morning service where everyone was coming in here to serve? And I know a lot of ladies are saying, now, Michelle, I can't believe you just said that, because I just spent 2 hours cooking that ham and cooking that food, and I'm serving, serving, serving. I hear that. But church membership is not about what the church gives us, but what we are giving. Let's go to the next slide. I did not draw that. I copied and stuck it in there. Think of your body. Raise your hand. Tell me a couple of body parts, or just tell me one body part that's real important or not important, whatever you think. Just tell me a body part. Hand, arms, your heart. Yes, your heart, your head. You need a head. Your eyes, ears, mouth. Most everything that everyone has said has been on the outside. Think about your inside, except for the heart. Your brain, your kidneys, your pancreas, your liver, your skeleton. You'd be a big blob up on the floor without your skeletal system. In your intestines, your colon, your feet, your femur, your muscles, the blood that you have. Without that blood, you'd be gone. What about your nervous system? All it takes is for that one cord to get cut and you can't walk. Which I actually saw a real live, spinal cord. And I thought it was just one cord. But what it is there's many different circles. I have a picture of it. I probably should have put it up there. There's many different circles and they're encased in like this, yeah, it's like a sheath, like a skin of sorts, like a layer of together. And so you have all these different circles, and it's all together like that. And that thing was about, I mean, it was probably like that. It was amazing. So, you know, we think of our spinal cord, and my mind always thought, well, it's just like a little, you know, cord. But it's a good-sized thing going up into your brain. But every part is so important. And we've heard this. I want you to sit there right now and think about a part of your body that's been giving you trouble. You didn't take it out and throw it away, did you? You didn't chop it off. You dealt with it. You just kept moving. You did what you had to do, but you didn't get rid of it. It's still there. It's still attached, right? Am I wrong? Not unless it was your gallbladder and they probably took it out. But it's still a part of who you are. So as a body of believers, if I rub you the wrong way, if I've got those little, you know, porcupines and I kind of rub you the wrong way, are you going to throw me out the door? Please don't. We are, I would have to say, I mean, I've been in several churches, not just as a member, but also visiting, and I can honestly say that our church is probably one of the most loving, accepting churches I have ever been in. And there is a reason for that, which we're getting to. Let's go to the next slide. Ephesians 2, 19 through 22. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and are of God's household, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building, being fitted together, is growing into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also being built together into a dwelling of God in the Spirit. There's two things being built here. Did you guys catch that? Verse 21, in whom the whole building being fitted together is growing into a holy temple in the Lord. And in whom you also are being built together. So not only are we being built together as a temple in the Spirit, but we individually are being built as a temple. We should be able, if someone walked up to you and said, and I'm not going to embarrass you, but if someone walked up to you and said, what area is God working on in your life right now? And you know that that's the area he's working on. You should be able to tell somebody if they ask you that. Because you're working with God. You might be wrestling with him. You might be in the test, and you know you're on the lookout for the next time he's going to test you in that area to see if he's taking you to that next level. He doesn't allow those tests just so he can see how you're going to react. He puts those tests there so you know how you're going to react if you've really submitted in those areas to him. Amen? So you're being built together individually, and if we are all yielding to the Holy Spirit and the work that he's doing on the inside of us, and we are being fitted together as a church member, we're not just here to see what someone can do for us, but we're here to serve one another. We're here to do our part, no matter what giftings and callings we have. We're here to do our part. Then guess what? That's when revival can really show up. That's when the Holy Spirit can move, because the closer we get to him, the less flesh we have manifesting. The closer we get to one another. It didn't say we're just going to pile a couple rocks up on top of each other. It says fitted jointly together. We're talking a wall that cannot fall easily. Fitted together. The steps that go up to the temple, Solomon's temple, were built in a way that they weren't uniform at all. I mean, it was nothing like this up here. We can just say, hey, we're going in. Every stone was a different size, a different shape. But they fitted them together in such a way that whenever they would go up to worship, they had to think about what they were doing. They couldn't just run up. Hey, we're here to worship. Worship took thought. Worship takes thought. It's not just something we run into and just sing a song and run out. But those stones, my point is, those stones were put there specifically in the way that they were, fitted together for a reason. Okay? God has a plan. We are his family. We are brothers and sisters, and Jesus is our brother. The Bible says that. He's already gone through what we've gone through, and we can talk to him about what we're going through. Amen? Pastor Bob's already gone through Colossians 3:13. Forgiveness. How important forgiveness is. Extremely important. Can you go one slide? Yes, that one. One of the things that I have seen more than not is people go into a church and they're like, well, we're looking for a church. They'll come here. Hey, you know, my name's so-and-so. We're just looking for a church. And a lot of people don't realize what they're really looking for. They might want great worship. And if the worship's great, they're going to stay. Or they want the coffee bar. Because they're not ones to make their own coffee. They want to get their coffee, their free coffee and biscuit. Or they're looking for children's ministry because they have a lot of children and they want to make sure that the children are taken care of, which is important. But each church building, so to speak, or each of our churches tend to have their own anointings on them. There might be a church that's primarily focused on teaching, which I came from a church that was like that, that was all about Bible studies, and I was there 4 or 5 times a week, you know, study, study, study. Then there's churches that are more focused on missions, missionary. They're always sending someone out. There's churches that are focused on drama and the arts. There's one up in Somerville that Miss Doris introduced me to that is very focused on evangelizing and street ministry. It's just amazing. Our church is more like a hospital. We have people that are here that are core people that have been here for a while, but we have people that come in that have so many different sicknesses in the spirit realm, and they'll come in and we just love up on them. Love up on them like doctors and nurses, and each of us are ministering to these people, you know, in different areas that they have needs. And that's building them. But they may not be here. This may not be their church when it's all said and done. They may be coming through for a time. But when people are looking for a church, one of the things that they need to understand is if they're looking to be planted somewhere, it needs to be a like ministry of what their calling is, so that they can fit in and function in their anointing. If I am called as a prophet and I speak words of prophecy, I can tell you a couple of denominations I could not go to because they're not going to allow the Spirit of God to flow through me in prophecy. They're just not. So there is something to be said. Yes, we are all the body of Christ, this church, that church, these. If we believe in Jesus and he is our Lord and Savior and we have put him as Lord over our life, however, for our spiritual growth, we have to be planted in a place that we're going to grow. And that is important. So that's what this list is up here, is just to give you a little bit of an understanding of some of the ministries that are out there and what their focuses are. And so when you're talking to someone who might be looking for a church, you may not want to tell them, hey, ours is like a hospital. You're sick. Come see us. But you can let them know what ministries we do have available for them, and we can counsel them and all that. And one of the reasons why we have not really made huge changes with praise and worship is because there's folks here that love the contemporary worship. There's folks here that love the style of music Linda does or loves the way that Rachel does. And we're not just going to yank one out and say, well, we can't do that kind of music because someone doesn't like it. It's worship to the Lord, and others have just come in, and they're just yielding to it, and they're like, you know what? In my heart, I'm going to worship the Lord, and it's okay. It's okay. But there'll be people that'll come in and say, well, y'all need to do it like this, or you need to do it like that. We are led by the Holy Spirit, and if God changes it, guess what? It's all right. No one's going to lose any sleep over it. Someone wants to be the worship leader? Give me a call. Someone wants to lead the youth? Give me a call. You want to do the newsletter? You want to clean the church? Give us a call. We'll be happy to let you function. It's all there. And there are ministries we don't have here that God has put in your heart. I mean, look at Mr. Will Till over here flipping the script. You know, whatever God's put on your heart, share it with the leadership. Share it with your brothers and sisters. Miss Martha, we had the closet. It was at the right time. It inspired us to be able to have Martha's closet later on to help all those people who were in that fire that needed help. You never know how each of our lives are going to inspire the next generation or the next person. So follow what God's put in your heart. And if you're not sure what your calling is, please, if you don't know, call me, tell me after the service. I have this, I think it's 132 questionnaire, spiritual gifts test. I will be happy to give it to you, and I won't give you any of the answers to it. So you can sit there and answer them honestly, and you can come back, and we'll look at it, and I'll show you, hey, these are your gifts. This is what you're strong in. And then you can pray over it and see what doors God may open for you in the ministry of that area. Amen? All right. Now, this was interesting. Wow. 1 Corinthians 13 is just wow. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 5. It talking about love, does not hold grudges and will hardly notices when others do it wrong. Pastor Bible tell you, in counseling, there's times where couples will come in, and almost every single time, I think I have mentioned, ladies, don't correct your husbands. Husbands, don't correct your wives over every little thing. Just love them. Love them where they're at. If they're not making you happy, just close your mouth. It's okay. It's okay. This world isn't about us and us being happy and making it all fun. Live a little. Enjoy. Enjoy where you are. When people, do you want people coming to you to say, hey, you need to stop this, glue this on, grow that there, move that from here to there, change, change, change? People want to be accepted for who they are right now. If someone walked in this building and came into my youth group with bright purple hair with yellow tips on it, and a tongue ring that you can see because you can hear it clang in their teeth, whatever they dress at, do you think I'm going to go up to that child and say, I'm sorry, but you need to change everything about yourself to be in my class? No. Now, if they wanted to be in a place of leadership at some point, you know, we may need to kind of, you know, talk to them and say, you know, as an example, you know, if I came in as a youth leader and I had all this stuff going on, would you want your children to come to me and I'll be like, hey man, you want to go get a tat? You know? No, we have to be careful in leadership, you know, certain things we have to look at. However, love, love, love. Let's go to this next. This was really amazing to me what Dr. Rainer put in the book about this. Most Bible readers will speak glowingly of 1 Corinthians chapter 13, commonly known as the love chapter. It is read at weddings. It is used for a husband to declare his love for a wife, or vice versa. It is preached to demonstrate a full meaning of agape, or unconditional love. Well, there's nothing wrong with using the love chapter in these contents. Its original meaning was to demonstrate how church members relate to one another. How church members are to relate to one another. The more we align with 1 Corinthians 13, I believe the more of God can flow through us. Love conquers all. God conquers all. God is love. God is love. Let's go to the next slide. Amen. We're bringing it to a close here. Church membership is functioning membership. It's not just your name on a roster. It's not just, I mean, you look at our roster right now, and this is a fact. I mean, if you look at any church membership roster, about one-third of those folks are in church. And out of those one-third, most of the time, based on what Dr. Rainer found out in a study of about 6 or 8 years, only a third of them are functioning. So in our case, I know everyone here is doing something. Church membership is functioning membership. And so if there's one thing I can do is encourage you, function in what God has called you to do. Let's go to the next slide, and let's finish up these last few words from Dr. Rainer in the book. Sure, you can remain on the role of many churches and never show up or give. You can remain an active member in other churches by being a CEO or a Christian on Christmas and Easter only. You can even be a revered member in a number of churches by giving a nice sum of money to the church each year, even though you never lift a finger in service or ministry. But please understand, this type of membership is not biblical membership. That approach to membership is man-made, man-centered, and is totally contrary to what the Bible teaches. It has no place in our churches. biblical church membership gives without qualification. Typical membership views the tithes and offerings as joy instead of joy in the giving of it. There are no strings attached. Typical church membership services and ministers as a natural way of doing things. And that did not make sense, and I am really needing to reread these before I put it up there. Biblical church membership is functioning membership. Each part of the body is to function the way it was made and created to function. Your eye does not smell, and the ear does not see. The way it's created to function is the way it's to function. If Willie Tillman sat in the back row and did nothing, what? No worship? No teaching? No interviews? No pictures? No. What? No, we're not having that. One of the ongoing questions you should ask yourself and God in prayer is, how can I best serve my church or my church family? You should never ask yourself if you should be serving your church. Should I be serving? That should never be a question. If you are a member, you must be a functioning member. It's just that simple. Now, this next screen is a pledge. Each part of this book, it breaks it down into different sections. And each time I come up here to teach, it's going to be different. This was more laying a foundation. I know everyone is tired. It's a little warm in here, too. Maybe it's just me. But we had to lay this foundation of where Dr. Rayner is going. And as we move on, these are the headings of the other chapters that we're going to be talking about. And each one, we're going to be doing it in a little bit of a different way. Chapter 2 is, I will be a unifying church member. Chapter 3, I will not let my church be about my preferences and desires. Chapter 4, I will pray for my church leaders. Chapter 5, I will lead my family to be healthy church members. Chapter 6, I will treasure church membership as a gift. So we're going to be going through those over the next few weeks. Last but not least, let's all stand just for a moment. And he has these pledges at the end of each of the chapters that he goes through to kind of get everyone to corporately come together and really agree to be a part of what he's explaining in each of the chapters. And so we're going to read this together. Hopefully you can see it. If not, just kind of agree in your heart. This is the first pledge. I am a church member. I like the metaphor of membership. It's not membership as in a civic organization or a country club. It's the kind of membership given to us in 1 Corinthians 12:27. Now you are the body of Christ and individual members of it. Next slide. Because I am a member of the body of Christ, I must be in a functioning member. Whether I am an eye, an ear, or a hand, as a functioning member, I will give, I will serve, I will minister, I will evangelize, I will study, I will seek to be a blessing to others. I will remember that if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. If one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. 1 Corinthians 22, verse 26. All right, everyone have a seat. Now, I will encourage you at this point. I'm not used to standing up here and just kind of, you know, reading and getting into it. I'm used to walking all over the place and really preaching up a storm. But this, again, was laying a foundation for what we're getting ready to dive into. And as your homework, our next screen, if you'll read 1 Corinthians chapter 12 through 1 Corinthians 14, chapter 14. So that would be 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 13, and 14. Those three chapters he keeps going back to over and over again in the book, and it will help you to understand some of the things that we're getting ready to dive into as well. All right? Okay.
Hallelujah.